In the previous clips, we have seen how precipitations develop and how they are distributed over the Earth. Now, it is time to look at what happens to the rain falling on the ground. Where does it go? How does it reach the sea? In summary, we want to look at the water cycle. The knowledge developed here will also be of great importance for Module 6 of this MOOC. To look at the water cycle, we can start from the sea, where water evaporates and is taken over by the overlying air masses. Driven by the low pressure dominating in warm conditions, the air will rise and will be carried by winds towards the continents. By cooling, the air mass will become saturated in water and rain will fall. Precipitations can either go along the ground, in which case that one talks of runoff, or can infiltrate into the ground. Following different paths, all waters will eventually reach rivers and the sea. In this model, we only look at the subaerial path. We will focus on the underground one in the Module 6, the hydrogeology module. Water falling in areas of low elevation and covered with vegetation will only move slowly, will interact with rocks and contribute to the formation of soils, a key component for various organisms. Slowly but surely, waters will then reach and join creeks and rivers. In other areas, for instance in the poorly vegetated mountainous regions, things will be faster and rougher. Here, valleys are narrow and steep and torrents will have a more tumultuous course. Waters will form first creeks, then larger torrents and rivers, getting out of the narrow mountain valleys, traversing the large plains and eventually reaching the sea. During this journey, a number of things will change, from the slope and the vertical section of the valley and the amount of water flowing through it, eventually impacting the ability of the river to erode or, on the contrary, to deposit sediments. It is useful at this stage to introduce a few theoretical concepts. The carrying capacity is a measure of the amount of sediment transported by the river and of the grain size it can carry. Carrying capacity is primarily dependent on the velocity of the water flow. The equation shows how the flow velocity depends on the discharge and on the section of the channel it is flowing through. Imagine, for instance, that we have a sudden increase of water discharge. If the channel section cannot change significantly, this will result in a strong increase in velocity and therefore of carrying capacity. Let us briefly look at changes in velocity and channel sections along the river. A very important feature controlling the water velocity is the gradient of the river. Rivers in stable settings are steep close to their core source and become gentler asymptotically reaching a horizontal level called base level. The most obvious base level is obviously the sea. The air profile is generally stable, but if the base level is modified, for instance, by tectonic uplift or sea level change, then the river will start eroding or depositing in order to go back as soon as possible to equilibrium. In general, the steeper the slope, the higher the flow velocity. From the source to the sea, valleys generally become wider, which implies that speed decreases. In the same direction, however, river's discharge increases because the affluent rivers join the main river. As long as the section remains constant, this results in a slight increase in velocity. A way to link the water speed of water flow with erosion, transport, or sedimentation is the use of a diagram in which the velocity of the flowing water is plotted against the grain size. Let us how to read the Ullstrom plot. Imagine you have a river flowing at 5 cm per second. The corresponding line falls completely in the field of sedimentation, which means that the river will not be able to pick up any clasts, not even the small ones, and the river will not erode. Consider now a river flowing at 100 cm per second, represented by the green line. This river will be able to pick erode clasts larger than 5 mm, which might line on the riverbed. On the contrary, the river will pick up all grains smaller than 5 mm and larger than 0.04 mm. Interestingly enough, finer grain clasts will not be removed from the river bottom because of the electric forces keeping these clay minerals together. If water flows at 800 centimeters per second, it will remove all grain sizes it finds on its way. Bedrock will be found on the river floor. The Houston diagram is also very useful to learn what happens when the speed of flow changes. Imagine that a river loaded with all possible grain sizes and flowing at 800 centimeters per second suddenly decreases its speed to 60 or 70 centimeters per second. Then it will dump most of the sediments and will only carry grain sizes smaller than 0.05 millimeters. Imagine, on the contrary, what happens during a large increase in water velocity, reaching, for instance, 700 centimeters per second. From the Houston diagram, you can see that the river becomes erosive. Precipitations are not always in the form of water, but can also take place as snow. When this goes on for a long time, this can eventually lead to glaciers. Glaciers are very powerful agents of erosion and transport. Under their own weight, glaciers move constantly down the valleys. The movement is slow, typically around 1 meter per day, but do not underestimate them. They can be very slow, but they can be very strong. Part of the downward movement is accommodated by gliding on the bedrock. Part of it is taken over by the solid-state flow of ice. Descending towards lower altitudes, the glacier will reach warmer regions and ice will start melting. As a result, there will be a point where the downward movement of the glacier is compensated by melting. The glacier has reached a steady state, characterized by a stable position of the glacier front. This, however, does not mean that the entire glacier is inactive. The ice will keep on moving from the high to the low altitude, constantly carrying sediments off scraped from the bottom and the sides of the valley to the front, like a conveyor belt. All these sediments are transported towards the tongue of the glacier, where it is deposited, forming moraines. At present, the size of the moraines is limited, but this has not always been the case, as we've seen when looking at climate change. During ice ages, huge glaciers eroded major valleys, presently, for instance, visible in the Alps and elsewhere, depositing huge amounts of sediments at the glacier front.